as Napoleon breakfasted with his generals, his brother Jerome brought fresh intelligence. Blücher planned to march from Wavre to join Wellington.
Stupidity! After a battle like Ligny, it is impossible for them to join forces. We have 90 chances in our favour, and not 10 against us.
The British and the Austrians are special in this sense, that they had been fighting more or less continuously since 1792 in the case of the Austrians, 1793 in the case of the British, had expended gigantic sums of treasure and oceans of blood over the previous quarter of a century. The Austrians had gone bankrupt in 1811. The British were suffering serious financial difficulties, as indeed all the powers were. So there's a general determination to put a stop to this menace once and for all.
The good old war horse Blücher had decided to go, much against his chief of staff's advice. His chief of staff was Gneisenau, who harboured some resistance, who acting together with the British. Blücher ordered them to make for Plancenoit, for Waterloo, as fast as they could, and to join the battle, the final battle, against Napoleon.
At 11 o'clock, after an hour's sleep, Napoleon woke refreshed and took up position on high ground near the farm of Rossomme. Mounted on his white mare, Désiré, he surveyed the field. He must have been extremely confident. The rain had stopped and his army was numerically superior, having 72,000 men against 68,000. He also boasted 90 more guns. At 11:25, Napoleon gave the signal for his guns to open fire, whilst Jerome attacked the enemy's right in order to draw off troops from Wellington's centre. The bombardment continued for an hour and a half. Then Napoleon ordered the Comte d'Erlon's first corps to attack.
Napoleon, in the end, is to be castigated for the French tactics at Waterloo. In particular, it's to be argued that successive frontal attacks played to the strength of the defensive firepower of the British and Allied forces, and that he didn't outmaneuver his opponents. There's some truth in that. I mean, it could have been a battle that could have been, he could have tried to make much more of an attempt to outflank his opponents or to attack them hard in the flank. He doesn't. Why? Well, in part, time. He wants a quick battle. He wants to engage them before they can retreat. In part, his actual physical and mental state. He's ill, he's tired, he's run down, and I think it's fair to say that there are also specific problems with the French army. It's a new one. It is underpowered in terms of artillery. The artillery itself, the deployment is delayed by overnight rainfall, which has ensured that the soil, the clay soil, has become a bit waterlogged, so that delays the battle. But having said that, it is still a battle that has to be fought.
The artillery pounding had caused surprisingly little damage in the English ranks. Knowing the power of the French artillery, Wellington had drawn his men back on the reverse slopes. He then moved them to the top of the ridge, where they fired down on d'Erlon's troops, inflicting substantial losses.
The guard were confronted by some opponents who were not exactly slouches themselves, and the British Army's reputation for musketry was beautifully upheld at Waterloo. They shot the guard to pieces, and the guard couldn't take it, and they crumbled and fled.
As the French retreated, the Scots Greys pursued them. Napoleon sent in the 6th and 9th Cuirassiers against them. The Scots were wiped out, but at a price. The French had lost 5,000 men. At 1:30 in the afternoon, Napoleon moved his headquarters to La Belle Alliance. There, a surprise awaited him. Jerome's intelligence had been correct. Blücher's advance guard had arrived. Suddenly, Napoleon was forced to fight on two fronts.
The appearance of Blücher on the scene at Waterloo in 1815, in a way, is of symbolic importance. Blücher was a very elderly gent by the standards of Napoleonic warfare. And yet he possessed the necessary reserves of physical stamina and moral courage to get his army, which man for man was probably the best army in any of the Allied combat units, or indeed and certainly superior to Napoleon's troops, to get them going and to get them there in time. Blücher was a very interesting, extremely aggressive and bloodthirsty person who hated Napoleon and the French and was seeking to avenge, as he saw it, a deep sense of humiliation inflicted on Prussia by Napoleon after 1806. So, in a way, Blücher personifies a major change which has taken place in the way in which the old regime powers waged war. Now they have learned all the lessons of French revolutionary and Napoleonic warfare and are applying them with deadly effect against those that created them in the first place.
Ney launched the main assault against Wellington, even though horse after horse was shot from beneath him. At 6:30, his efforts were rewarded when he captured the farm of La Haye Sainte. Napoleon needed to act swiftly before Blücher's main force arrived. His plan was to send 5 battalions of guards up the slopes of Mont Saint-Jean under the command of Marshal Ney. Despite quick and accurate fire from the English, the guards pressed on. At this point, a second Prussian corps, under the Graf von Zieten, arrived and attacked the guards from the right. At the same time, Wellington sent 3 regiments of hussars charging down the hill, where they broke one of the guards' squares. News rapidly spread. The guards, once thought invincible, had been scattered in confusion. Napoleon now knew all was lost. He tried to retreat in good order.